met Claude first in Cargès in 1970, but our real encounter took place only a few years after, in 73, when I was following a course that he was teaching in Orsay on relativistic ignorance, if I remember correctly, and especially the year after, when he asked me to join him as his assistant for a course that he was just about to teach on quantum field theory in Orsay. And that was the beginning of a great adventure since then to our book. And that was also more or less at the same time that we started to work on a research project on the field theory of the Zuber. And if I'm counting right, we wrote together as many as 25 joint publications. So when you look at Claude's career as a researcher, what I find most frightening is that from the very start, he's able to work on many different things. So officially, he's a particle physicist. He starts his, he's making his thesis with Maurice Jacob on current algebra, weak interactions. But already in the 60s, he's writing papers with many different people on classical and quantum field theory, group theory applications to physics, both formal and really applied group theory, statistical mechanics, Zuber model again, mathematical physics. So that's very striking to me that he's able to grasp so many things at the same time. I'm not going to discuss these things because I know that Edouard on his last day will review his early days, as he says. I would like to pose a little about work done with Roger Bagnon and Jean-Michel Wolff in the mid-70s, immediately after Ken Wilson's seminal paper, or rather seminar, because Wilson gives a seminar in the Orsay, the Summer Institute, and I think it's Claude that was attending, and Claude immediately understands the importance of the idea of discretizing gauge theories on lattice. And immediately he returns with, as Michel was saying, full of enthusiasm to the lab and attracts Roger and Jean-Michel to work on that. And I think it's important because Michel was talking about hard objects. So this is clearly the case. Thanks to this work, Saclay becomes one of the hot spots where this new subject is developed. So there are three important papers and the physics report, which are very influential. Soon after, we have the good fortune of collaborating with Giorgio Parisi. Giorgio Parisi was visiting IHES in Pionsovet, and we start to work with him on large orders of perturbation theories. So before I proceed, let me show you where this picture comes from. It's a little part of this picture that I like very much, where both Claude and Roger Morel look very nice. So I like this picture. I don't know who is sitting there.
Daniel Bessis.
No, it's not Daniel Bessis, I don't think. Anyway. Okay, so to proceed, after that, at the end of the 70s, there is again a very exciting period where we start to work on matrix integrals and combinatorics, a subject that will reappear in this conference. So there is the paper BIPS, known under the acronym of BIPS, which is written at the time with Brezin and Parisi, and a paper with Bessis, and the so-called HCIZ formula, IPhT-TV, Zuber, I'm sorry for that. This formula is written at the time. So for those who don't know the story, with Claude, we find beautiful formula, very useful. And soon after, or a few years after, people tell us, in fact, this thing was known for a long time by mathematicians, especially if you look at the work of IPhT-TV. So since then, the formula has been known as the IPhT-TV formula. Very well. Okay, so those are very exciting times. I still remember these things. Now, after that, Claude works once again on very difficult topics, lattice models, with a bunch of collaborators, very different projects with different people. random geometry, so the subject of the present meeting, random geometry, random interactions. And we, there's a work with Brezin, David Gross, that Edouard will report, that we'll review on Friday. Jean-Marc, Bernard Derrida, and others, I'm certainly forgetting many people. Then comes a period, the last decade, that I would like to call the golden period of control field theory in Saclay. So we joined against forces and was soon joined by a bunch of bright young people, researchers, postdocs, students. Some of them will become permanent in this lab. And here I've given only the names of those who wrote papers with Claude. There were many others there in the orbit somehow of this group. So this is a very exciting time. I think the fairly important works are done at that time, the AD classification, work on null vectors, connections with integrable systems, etc. Then I realized that I forgot to talk about some work done with Michel Godin and Frédéric de Sage, which is also more or less in the same, on Laplace wave function, which is more or less in the same vein. In his late years, as Raphael was mentioning, Raphael understood that, Claude is switching to things that are more and more mathematical, and he develops a strong interest for algebraic geometry and connections with physics through either matrix integrals or control field theory. So there are papers written either alone or in collaboration with Michel or with Philippe. So this makes it clear that Claude is able to work on a very broad spectrum of subjects, and that he has also a special gift at collaborating with people. Now, again, this picture here is taken from a picture that I took in Esuch in 82. And I like this picture because it's very typical of Claude. Claude is fully concentrated listening to what Michael Peskin is explaining. And you can see here the cigarette here with an ash in a vertical position. So the obvious improbable balance of the ash. And still Claude doesn't pay attention. He's fully concentrating listening to Michael. Very typical of Claude. Okay, so then I would like to say a few words about Claude and mathematics. Claude was obviously a lover of mathematics. So I mentioned already group theory, I mentioned combinatorics, but he also developed interest in the early 80s, he developed interest in number theory, in particular billiards, connection with alpha energy was. This is in fact the reason that took him to study control field theories, and with different collaborators again, together with Jean-Marc, Pierre Moussa, and Michel Bertschmidt, they organized a very important winter school in Esuch on number theory and physics. And then in his late years, as I mentioned already, he develops a strong interest in algebraic geometry, conservation integral, modular space, quotidic, descent d'enfant, etc. And I remember that when he was already ill and in hospital, he was still working, and he had a new research project on the application of the permutation group to replica symmetry. Okay, so obviously, group theory in particular, but mathematics in general, was deep in his heart. And I would like to conclude by saying that I think that it's fair to say that Claude played a very important role in bringing together or bringing closer mathematics, mathematicians, and physicists, theoretical physicists. And I give this winter school as an example, but there were many other opportunities, many other occasions where Claude was acting as a go-between. So there were conferences, there were seminars in Orsay in Paris that he was regularly attending, helping to organize devoted to mathematics and physics. Okay, so I couldn't find any picture of Claude with a mathematician, but at least I have that picture with Louis Michel, who had more or less the same interest as Claude, which are physics and the group theory. And I like this picture very much too. Then, as it was already mentioned by Michel, Claude liked to teach. And he made that in many occasions, in many places. So there were either graduate courses or more advanced courses given in all kinds of institutions, Equipment Technique, so-called DOA in Orsay or elsewhere, Marseille, Lausanne, etc., etc. There are beautiful lectures given in the late 80s at CERN. And from all these lectures, two books came out. There was this book that was already mentioned, and the book by Claude and Jean-Michel Rouff on statistical field theory, which came 9 years later. And I'm pretty sure that had Claude lived longer, I'm pretty sure that he would have written a third book. I don't know if it would have been topological field theory or confound field theory, but I'm pretty sure that he would have found the energy to write a third book. Also, as was mentioned before, he was the mentor of many junior physicists, the official and unofficial students, but not only those, many others, and I'm well pleased to testify that he was very influential to many of us. So here's a picture taken in Kyoto, where I think it's in Kyoto, where he was given several lectures. And as was already said, Claude was not only a great scientist, he was also a man of ever open mind and adaptability, as I'm saying here. First, because of his great scientific culture, he was able to have a very unique role in this lab as a go-between to people, capable of interacting with everybody, suggesting things, stimulating people on many, many different subjects. And he was not only a scientist, he was also a man of culture. And this came back from his childhood, where he was educated, and his interest for culture in general, literature, history, art was developed. And he had a fantastic culture. And finally, I would like to say that he had a quite unique personality, a mixture of elegance and a devastating sense of humor sometimes, but a lot of charm. And obviously, a lot of very, very influential, and his influence is lasting to this day to those who are lucky enough to know him and to work with him. Okay, so, and I think I have a last picture here. Again, a picture that is quite typical. Cyrano is telling a story, and I can imagine that Claude is just about to deliver a little short comment. And again, very typical. All right, so this is what I wanted to say about Claude, but as you can imagine, I'm deeply moved to see that. Now, let me come to doodles. And first, I would like to explain what doodles are. So doodles is a vague word. It's sometimes used in different meanings. So what do mean would be translated in French by comptage de gribouillis. And this is illustrated by this wonderful masterpiece. But in fact, this is not quite accurate, because contrary to what this beautiful thing is showing, I'm going to look at curves which are smooth. So there should be no angular points like here. And even more importantly, there should be a single component. Okay, so remove the blue part, and you'll be left with something that may account as a doodle. Okay, so more precisely, a doodle will be an open or closed. For me, it will be mainly a closed, smooth curve with a single component, as I explained, and of course, it's self-intersecting. So there are n self-crossings. And this curve will be drawn in a plane, on a sphere, or more generally in a higher general surface. And there are only double points, And at those double points, the curve is transverse. So the tangent vectors are distinct. So in mathematical terms, this is what mathematicians call the image of an inversion of an oriented, unoriented circle, if it's closed, into a surface, a two-dimensional surface, which may be itself oriented or unoriented, call it sigma. And these curves are considered up to topological equivalence, excuse me, and topological equivalence meaning by the action of the diffeomorphism group, either the orientation preserving one or the general one. So in this talk, I'll be mainly talking about immersions into closed surfaces, the sphere and higher genus surface rather than plate. So to explain you why it's relevant and important, let me show you first the comparison between a curve in a plane and a curve in a sphere. I claim that here are the five possible immersions or curves, if you want, with two double points in a plane. And then if you look at these things, look at this one, for example, imagine it's living on a sphere. Obviously, you can take this part of the curve and break around the sphere, bring it on the left, and you find that curve. Okay. So on the sphere, these three drawings are equivalent. So there are five curves in the plane, but only two on the sphere. Okay. Likewise, on the issue of genus, so those were living in the plane of the sphere. Now, this thing here, with again two double points, and this point in the middle is not playing the same role. What it represents is in fact a diagram which is non-planar and which may be drawn more conveniently, more correctly on a torus. And now you understand that the extra point here is just representing the effect of perspective. So this is why this concept of genus of the curve matters. Then I mentioned that the surface could be oriented on Earth. So why is that relevant? Well, here are two curves with n equals 6 double points. I claim that these two curves are inequivalent if you are living on an oriented plane or sphere. However, if you admit a mirror symmetry, mirror transformation, then there are up to a different information. There are mirror images of one another. Okay, so it will be counted as a single curve on the unoriented sphere. And lastly, I mentioned that you could also orient the circle. Then it's easy to, here are cases with three double points, n equals 3. I claim that these two curves are inequivalent. There is no way to deform one into the other. However, the trefoil, the so-called trefoil, here, is in fact equivalent to its reverse. Again, it's a little jiggling with this thing, which will convince you that this is true. Okay, so you have to make sure which category of which type of curve we are discussing when you discuss these things. Now, the question is how to count, and or even better, how to list these curves, these immersions. And before that, natural question is, why is that interesting? So I have several answers to that. First answer is this one. And indeed, let me show you the 27 so-called indecomposable, irreducible immersions of an unoriented circle into an unoriented sphere with n equal 8 double points. So what these barbarous terms mean here is that you cannot cut into two pieces any of these curves by cutting either a vertex or two lines. So physicists would call them two particle irreducible. So there are many more if you're relaxing this condition, but it reduces to 27 when you impose these conditions. And this is a new result. This thing was not known before. So it may sound childish, but I was very pleased when I managed to
it goes like this, this.
So that's the first method. Then a more politically correct answer is it may be relevant for the statistic of random curves. And that's a weak excuse to talk about this subject at this meeting. But I'm not going to develop that. Then I would say that the problem is a mathematical challenge, because after all, this is a problem that has been considered by mathematicians as imminent as Gauss or Arnold more recently, and many others. Also, it's, to some extent, it's relevant for null theory. Indeed, and here we see what the problem is. When you are looking at null theory, if you want to count knots or list or classify knots, first step is to look at a particular subfamily of knots, which are so-called alternating knots, in which when you follow the thread, you encounter alternatively overcrossings, undercrossings, undercrossings. Okay, alternating knots. So a link, for those who are not familiar with terminology, links would be a knot with some components, like this. In contrast, knots are precisely what I was defining as a doodle, but in another way somehow. So the counting of alternating links is something which is well known. It has been derived in the late 80s, not even recently, by these two people. The computation was reproduced and extended by Quincy Justin and myself, and using the matrix integral technology. So this question of counting links is under control. Now, much more difficult would be to count things in which you impose that you have a single component, okay, as I do with my doodles. So the problem that I'm considering is related to the question of, that you ask in knot theory. And finally, and in fact, this shows that the problem of counting doodles is a challenge for the theoretical physicist. Because what would any of us do in such a problem, in front of such a problem? We would say, oh, that's easy. We take a matrix integral. Instead of taking a single matrix, we take n of them, compute things for generic n. Okay, so somehow you're introducing n colors for each time. And at the end, you let n go to zero. So that will single out the contributions coming from a single loop. Okay. So this is what we call the replica limit, n equal to zero limit, the replica limit. However, this nice problem fails. It fails because we don't know how to use this n matrix integral. And we don't know how to do that because we are lacking some sort of n generalization of this HCIZ formula. So we don't know how to carry out this calculation using matrix. So we have to find a substitute. And I claim that the possible substitute is group theory. Now, this sort of questions was examined and already discussed by many people, some people. So using different techniques, the sort of counting that I'm going to present has been done by the Russian school, Arnold and his collaborators, and Givalet, the Belgian mathematician, up to 5 crossings, 7 crossings for closed curves, and 10 crossings for open curves. Jesper Jacobsen and Paul Zijstein were able to extend that up to 19 crossings for open curves. And quite impressively, there is a recent work by Gilles Schaeffer and Paul Zijstein. We're able to look at the asymptotics of this problem by generating random samplings of what I call doodles. Sorry, their doodles are not exactly mine, but they are closely related. Up to, lo and behold, 10 to the 24th crossings. Amazing, isn't it? All right. So, as I said, how to count and how to list such immersions. So the main idea is to regard the curve as a four-valent map. map in the sense of mathematics, namely a graph embedded into a surface with faces homeomorphic to disks. And then make use of commutations to encode the map. And this is by no means a new idea. This is an idea that we learned with Claude and then NBCs 35 years ago from Jean-Michel. And recently I realized that this is something that was already known in mathematics literature, especially Walsh and Lehmann did some work on that. Essentially the same idea. And I was reading the other day that there may be something even earlier, but I wasn't able to trace it yet. Anyway, we don't claim that the idea is original, it's the application to the current problem, which is maybe original. So you look at permutations to encode the map, and the map will be labeled. And if you want to look at unlabeled things, maybe if you want to remove, if you want to remove the labeling, then what you have to do is to look at orbits of these permutations and a certain reparametrization or relabeling group. The interest is that now you see that what was before the diffeomorphism group is reduced to a final group of permutations. Much, much easier. Now there are several options, several ways of doing, of carrying out this program, and therefore there are several ways, several choices of permutations, several sets of permutations, several corresponding groups. So there are variants, but here's the basic idea. So to illustrate it, let me show you how we do that. Do it in the case of the so-called colored map. What do I mean by colored map? First, there's a trivial observation, which is that any planar in the world is important, planar or spherical, genus zero. Four-valent map may be two colors. And I'm talking about the coloring of faces. Okay? And saying that the graph, the map may be two colors means that adjacent faces will be colored in different colors. So the fact that it's four-colored is not important. What is important, four-valent is not important. The important thing is that the valency here at each vertex is even. That's very easy to see. So here is, for example, the case of this curve that I was calling before the trifold. And here is a possible coloring. I could have chosen the opposite coloring in which the central face would be shaded and the outside one as well. And instead of depicting things that way, you can look at it as a node. Okay, so you replace these crossings by overcrossing. So let's say that when you follow the thread, the shaded area will be always lying on your left. Okay, so when you approach a crossing over, the shaded area is on the left. That's the convention. So transforming a curve into a knot is equivalent, in the alternate knot, is equivalent to color it. Okay? Then, if you do that, then there is a way to encode the diagram by a pair of permutations. And again, I'm not totally sure whom should be credited for that. This is an idea that we used with Paul Saint-Justin about 12 years ago. Mireille, I was looking at your paper. I thought it was in your paper on constellations. You were using two correlations, but not exactly in the same setting, was it?
Corey and Mackie.
Okay. Maybe I missed it. Anyway, so there's a question mark here to be somehow filled. So what is the idea? N being, as I said before, the number of vertices, the number of edges in the graph, in the map, is 2n, and we are labeling each edge, therefore there will be 2n indices, and therefore the group will be acting, the permutation group will be S to N. And I'm encoding the way the indices are connected in the following way. So if I stands for the index here, I call sigma of I the index on the height when approaching the overcrossing, and I call tau of I the index on the left. And in that way, you have a perfect, faithful encoding of the pattern of indices at each crossing. Now, let me introduce a notation, rho, which will be the composition of sigma times tau minus 1, which will describe the way the two indices across the overcrossing are connected. And it's very clear that I goes, you go from I to j, rho of I, and vice versa, you go from j to rho, so j is what we call an evolution, square is equal to 1. Now, what is interesting of this thing? Well, you see that now in this framework, it's very easy to impose the constraints of one componentness, what I call one componentness, namely the fact that the curve has a single component. And this just amounts to saying that the composition of sigma times rho times sigma minus 1 times rho minus 1 belongs to the class of permutations with two equal cycles, what I call n squared. Bracket. Also, you can impose easily the genus of the corresponding map. You just write Euler's equation, 2 minus 2g is equal to the number of faces minus the number of edges plus the number of vertices, and the number of faces, you have white faces, you have shielded faces, the number of white faces is just the number of cycles of sigma, the number of shielded faces is just the number of cycles of tau. So you have this simple formula which relates, which gives you the genus in terms of sigma and tau. And finally, as I said, you have reduced the diffeomorphism group, excuse me, to a discrete group, namely a certain subgroup of S2. All right, so as I said, this is a perfect labeling of labeled maps. There's a one-to-one correspondence between labeled maps and this pair of sigma and tau. However, we are interested, ultimately, we are interested in unlabeled maps, unlabeled terrain curves. And those will correspond to orbits of these pairs under the action of, let me call that, reparameterization of change of label, namely, when you change sigma and tau into any of these conjugates, gamma times sigma times gamma is 1, and the same with tau, for any gamma in the group. Now, so the idea of orbits, again, is not very original, and that was already mentioned and used by several authors, but once again, I think this is original in that question of studying, in that study of immersions. Now, you may reduce this big reparametrization group by imposing constraints. For example, you may impose that along the contour, along the curve, at each other crossing, the indices are paired with consecutive integers. Okay? So at a certain crossing, it will be 1, 2, at another crossing, it will be 3, 4, etc. Okay? So this introduces the first restriction of the freedom, and now sigma remains the only variable. Tau is related to sigma, and rho is fixed rho by that. And this restricts the freedom of reparametrization to the what we call the centralizer of rho, namely those gamma that leave this condition invariant, that commute with rho zero. But you can do even better. You can do even better. That was obvious, but it took us several months to realize that. You can impose that not only the pairings at each other crossing are between consecutive integers, but in fact, since we have a single component by assumption, you can impose that along this component, The labels that you encounter are 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. The natural sequence. So one way or the reverse way, depending on the orientation. So this mean, the previous language means that this thing on which I was just as imposing that it had two equal cycles will be will be in fact the product of these two cycles, permuted cyclic permutation. Where is the pointer? Okay. So it will be just in that form. And now the what is the group of reparametrization? Well, if you think a little about it, there's not so much freedom. The reparametrization group is just the diagonal group or the cyclic group. Why is that so? Because you have two endpoints on the circle, but they are paired already, because many of the overcrossings, and the only freedom that you can have is either to change your orientation or to turn the patterns. So it makes the geometry of the problem quite easy and simple. You're dealing with two very simple groups, and depending whether you are looking at oriented curves or not, you look at the orbits under the cyclic group or under the diagonal. Also, an amusing remark is that this set of that I call U prime of permutation sigma that satisfy this condition, with all fixed as before, is not first it's a left coset. That's not very difficult to check. Namely, it's the product of that cyclic permutation by any element of the previous centralizer group, which means that these things are very easy to generate. And also, geometrically speaking, these things are just representing a set of open doodles. If you think about it, what you have done is to consider. Let me finish. You are just considering an open curve, or was it close curve, but you're marking the point that you call one. So marking it means taking what people call the rooted Frobenius map. And therefore this set is just a set of rooted Frobenius maps. Jeremy,
you have that. I miss something. So you're considering doodles which are face decolorable.
Yeah.
So this is automatically the case in genus zero, but in higher genus.
I said genus zero. Indeed, I'm coming to that. You're perfectly right. If we go to higher genus, the assumption would be not innocent. So to summarize, we have found that orbits of this set U prime under the N give you bicolor dimensions of an oriented circle, under the set group will be give you bicolor dimensions of an oriented circle. And that's okay, let's keep the last one. All right. So, because time is short, maybe I skip that, which was the technical part where I was describing how these orbits are determined. And let me come now to the results. I claim that using this method, we are able to list, not only to number, but to list all possible bicolor dimensions of an oriented circle in the oriented sphere. This is what I was saying before. Not only on a sphere, but on a higher genus surface as well. And Jeremy's comment is quite appropriate. It's a non-trivial assumption to say that we are considering things that are bicolor. So later I'll show you that I can remove this assumption. But first, can we dispose of the color? Can we identify two diagrams that have that just differ by the colors? And the answer is yes, we can. And the way you do that is to examine whether the emulsion described by a certain sigma is equivalent in the sense of orbits of the diagonal or cyclic group, whether it's equivalent to the what I call the dual sigma, which describes the map with the opposite colors, in which two colors have been swapped. Okay. And that can be done by, there's an algorithm to do that, so we can remove the colors. So we'll be left with counting of curves that are bicolorable, but not bicolored. And can we dispose of the orientation of sigma, of vector sigma, the surface, the target? And the answer is yes, we can. And again, it's a matter of deciding whether a given sigma is chiral or not, which means whether it's equivalent or not to its mirror image, which turns out to be just this simple new permutation. Okay, so there's in principle there is an algorithmic discussion of this. So now to answer Jeremy's objection, we have done in this discussion, we have done the assumption that the class were bicolorable. In genus zero, it's a totally harmless assumption, but in non-zero genus, it makes a difference. It makes a big difference. And we expect that to have many more maps, curves, immersions, when you remove this assumption of bicolorability. So we propose to introduce a different way of coding things, different coding by permutations, but again, that's a bit technical, so I don't, maybe I'm not going to enter the details. But we know how to do it. Okay, so we can do. So finally, I see that summary is that we can do all kinds of things. We can compute, so these acronyms are not very nice looking, but I think if they are fairly explicit. So OOC would refer to immersions of a bicolorable, bicolored, little c, oriented circle into the oriented surface for given genus. Okay? And U, the first letter refers to the orientation of the circle, the second letter refers to the orientation of the surface, the letter C or B refers to whether you're looking at the coloration or not. And as I said, we can also count things when this bicolorability is balanced. And when we do that, we find curious identities. We have big tables, and we found strange coincidences. And it took us some time to understand the origin of these things. So for example, here is an identity, which to the best of my knowledge is non-trivial, which tells you that the number of UOC, refer to the little dictionary here, is equal to the number of OOB, etc. So we have several assumptions. Sometimes there are two for any even any n, sometimes there are two only for even n or odd n. Anyway, so to give you a little example, here is a counting of the spherical, so genus zero immersions. So bicolorable or not doesn't make any difference. But bicoloration does make a difference. And depending on the type of symmetry, you have all these countings. So there is something fairly obvious. You see that you go from one line to, in many cases, you go from one line to the next by basically a factor 2. But that's not true. It means that there are twice, roughly speaking, twice as many oriented dimensions as an oriented circle into an oriented thing. Why is that so? Because the exceptions will be a minority. The exceptions will come from special curves that have a special symmetry. And we know that these things become asymptotically negligible. So asymptotically, we expect to have a factor 4, 2, 2, 1 to this size. And we see that already at work here. The odd numbers mean that these things have not yet been cross-checked. All these things were done by two different methods, and the red ones are still to be verified by 1200. So here's the total number, and if you remember the plot that I showed you at the beginning, I have 27 irreducible, indecomposable curves with 8 crossings. See, this 27 is what is left from the original 14,614 curves in general. Okay. So there's a big reduction when you go from this general immersions to the particular irreducible decomposable. I may also add that I've been interacting with this Belgian mathematician, and by a totally different method, he confirmed this current. So it was also quite gratifying. Very good. So it's time for conclusion and questions. What we have obtained are numbers of curves and lists of curves up to 10 crossings. And we have also found a certain number of relations between numbers of different types of curves. And we have proofs of that. It's the formalism will give you a way to prove these things. I think we have also emphasized the importance of this bicolor Bayes assumption. Now, there remains many questions or many things to do. First, most of you think would be to extend this computation to higher n. I didn't have time to explain that, but we're making use of different algorithms. One of them, used by my friend Robert Cocro, uses a special software which is called Magma, which seems to be particularly well suited for group theory calculations. It's not like GAT, something which works for E groups. It's specially designed for finite groups. And it's extremely effective at computing centralizers, the equivalent classes, and these kind of things. So, unfortunately, Robert had only an old version of this thing on his personal computer. He just managed to have a new license, because it's a paid software. He had just a new license bought by his lab, so maybe he should be able to extend his computation to higher end. But okay, the real goal would be to find general formulae, and that's of course much harder. Now, what about the asymptotic behavior? This is another problem that was particularly examined by Gilles Schaeffer and Paul Saint-Justin. And they proposed a formula. For those of you who know the KPZ formula, it's something which comes from this connection between random systems and quantum gravity. And there's a formula like this with a certain number, which is fairly irrelevant. The important thing is that the exponent here, the critical exponent, should take this value, okay, which makes something of the order of minus 0.7, something like that. Now, can we see this behavior on the previous tables? Certainly we can't. Because what you have to know, what these people explained, is that if this is the asymptotic behavior, there should be correcting terms. So it should be multiplied by 1 plus a constant over log n. A constant over log n is something that decays very, very slowly. So certainly for n equal 10, you cannot expect to see this asymptotic behavior. Anyways, still, this is an issue. Can we use this permutation group approach to re-examine this question of asymptotics? I don't know. And also, you can wonder whether this same problem could be applied to other problems, particularly in this house, the question of meanders, which is very closely related to this question of curves, was examined. I'm wondering whether this permutation group business could be applied there. Okay, myself, I have a last question. And the last question is, would have Claude like this work? On the one hand, there is group theory, there is combinatorics, so you might have, but at the same time, looking at his little smile, I remember something that he said about a colleague, and I can hear him telling me the same, Jean Bernard, I'm afraid you have attacked a problem too difficult for you. Thank you.
he that is important in this problem? What is the condition where you have just one strand?
In fact, what Zuber and Paul just managed to do was to look at what they call doodles, which was not incorporating this condition of single element. So still they were able, by this random sampling, to generate curves with an arbitrary number of loops, and somehow to extrapolate from n, generate n to n equal to 0. Numerically. So they were not incorporating this condition that they had a single condition. It was a totally different approach. And then, of course, they could use KPZ.
Yeah, if I may add, this value of gamma corresponds to central charge minus 1.
Exactly.
And so there's a way of sort of guessing this minus 1. It's a market story. Question? I have one question for you, make it even more difficult. Can you use the same kind of techniques to tackle the problem of finite number of connected components, say 2, 3?
Any given number should be presumably accessible. It will be more and more difficult, but in principle, yes.
So you can translate it in terms of the
condition.
Yeah.
There is one more condition that you have to remember. When I said that you have, what was it? Maybe not. Yeah. In principle, when you specify a map by permutations, pair of permutations like this way, you have to make sure that the graph itself, the map itself, is connected. Okay. And this means that the permutation sigma and tau act transitively. This condition may be forgotten in this case because you have imposed that there is a single component, and then necessarily this condition is incorporated. If you relax that, you might have a little extra condition imposed, right? So it might make the thing even worse.
But your curious identity, do you have a proof of that?
We have a proof, yes. It's a matter of looking at symmetric class. I explained that we have these relations between what I call the dual and the mirror, and there's a third identity which tells you how the sigma is related to the sigma that describes the reverse curve when the orientation is reversed. So by looking at these things, you can find that, for example, the certain identities are impossible for n even.
So I guess for these open doodles, the doodle has to start and end in the same phase. What happens when you allow your drawing to stop anywhere?
No, you're right. It's important in an open doodle. It's important that the two initial and final points lie in the same phase, because, as I said, this is simply related to a rooted closed doodle. Now, if you allow the two endpoints to lie in different phases, I have absolutely nothing to say on that. Much worse, definitely.
And there is a nice experimental realization of a related problem where you replace the crossings by voided crossings, and you can also allow the two lines to go parallel, undistinguishable, for some time. So there is an experiment in me and Espa, my colleague, that Luciano, who implements this in hardware.
So that would be a case that I would call two particle reducible. Is that what you mean?
No, you replace the doodle crossings by avoided crossings.
Right.
And there's an additional complication which you can...
Just locally, as a given crossing.
Locally. And you want a single connected component
mm-hmm.
with open endpoint.
Mm-hmm.
Can you count this also?
I don't know. I've not looked at the problem. I cannot commit myself.
We have this in hardware.
Excuse me?
We have this in hardware. Generated for this.
Okay. You have to tell me more about it.
What about the case of Riemann surface with holes? Do you consider it a closed case?
Yeah, all of you are suggesting extensions which are very hard directions. It makes things much worse, certainly. Yeah.
Might be relevant.
Might be interesting or not, okay, but I have no clue, I have no good idea to offer it. Yeah. It's a different problem.
Yeah.
Much more difficult problem, I can imagine.